Have you ever really stopped to wonder where money comes from? I'm not just talking about the physical cash, but the total amount of money that exists in an economy. Well, today, we're going to unpack exactly how that number is calculated. And trust me, the answer is probably not what you think. Okay, let's just jump right in with the central puzzle we're going to solve. How can you start with 80 shekels and somehow end up with 160 shekels in the economy? It feels like it breaks the laws of math, right? But stick with me, because by the end of this, you'll see exactly how it works. We're going to do it step by step.
So first up, let's meet the main characters in this story. On one side, you've got the public. That's all of us, holding physical currency. You know, cash. And on the other side, you've got the banks. They play this super important middleman role, holding our deposits and also keeping some of that money in what they call reserves.
To make this whole thing really concrete, we're going to use three simple numbers for our entire explanation. So just imagine a little economy where the public has 60 shekels in cash, we'll call that C. They've put 100 shekels into their bank accounts, that's D for deposits. And of that 100, the banks are holding onto 20 as reserves, we'll call that R. So remember, C is 60, D is 100, and R is 20.
Okay, let's get into our first big concept. We're going to figure out where that 160 shekel number comes from. This is the first half of our puzzle.
So what exactly is the money supply? You'll often hear economists just call it M. And really, it's just the total amount of money that's available for the public to spend. It's the cash in your pocket plus all the money you can get to easily in your bank accounts.
And the way you calculate it is incredibly simple. You just take the currency held by the public, the C, and you add the deposits they have in the banks, the D. That's it. M equals C plus D. And bam! This is where we get the first part of our answer. Using our example numbers, we take the 60 in currency, add the 100 in deposits, and we get a total money supply of 160. See? Simple enough. So that explains the 160.
All right, so if the money supply is 160, then what in the world was that initial 80 we mentioned at the start? Well, that brings us to the other half of this equation, something called the monetary base.
The monetary base, which we'll call B, has this really cool nickname, high-powered money. And that's because it's like the foundation, the solid ground that the entire money system is built on. It's made up of the cash people are holding, plus the cash the banks are holding in their vaults.
Now, look closely at this formula, because it's a little different. To get the monetary base, you still start with the currency the public holds, C. But this time, instead of deposits, you add the bank reserves, R. So B equals C plus R.
And there it is. We take our 60 in currency, add the 20 in bank reserves, and that gives us a monetary base of 80. So now we've got both of our numbers on the table, a money supply of 160 and a monetary base of 80.
Which brings us right back to the main event. This is the core question. How does the banking system take a foundation of 80 and somehow build it up into a supply of 160? How does it literally double the money?
Well, the secret lies hidden inside the bank's own accounting, and it all comes down to one single, very important rule that they have to follow.
Let's just peek inside a simplified version of a bank's books. On the right, you see that 100 in deposits. That's a liability to the bank. It's money they owe to us. On the left are its assets. It keeps 20 of that 100 as reserves, and it loans out the other 80. And as you can see, it balances perfectly, 100 on each side.
This all leads us to the key that unlocks everything, the reserve ratio. This is simply the fraction or percentage of all deposits that a bank has to keep on hand as reserves. They're not allowed to loan this part out. It's the main control lever for money creation.
And finding this ratio is super easy. You just divide the reserves the bank is holding, R, by the total amount of deposits it has, D.
So in our example, we divide the 20 in reserves by the 100 in deposits, and we get 0.2. In other words, the reserve ratio is 20%. For every shekel someone deposits, the bank has to hold on to 20% of it.
Okay, now that we know this 20% ratio, we can finally pull back the curtain and show you how this little number becomes the engine that expands the entire money supply.
The formula for something called the money multiplier is so elegant, it's kind of beautiful. You just take 1 and divide it by that reserve ratio we just found.
So, with our reserve ratio of 0.2, the money multiplier is 1 divided by 0.2, which is 5. So the multiplier is 5. But what does that actually mean?
This is the absolute magic of our banking system, which is called fractional reserve banking.
Because banks only hold a fraction of their money in reserves, the whole system can multiply that base money. In our case, every single shekel held in a bank's vault can support 5 shekels of deposits out there in the economy.
So let's just trace the whole chain reaction from start to finish. It all starts with the central bank, which sets policies that influence the reserve ratio. That ratio then determines how big the money multiplier is. And finally, that multiplier takes the monetary base and expands it into the much, much larger money supply.
Now, it's really important to remember that this whole perfect mechanical process works based on one giant assumption, that banks are playing by the rules perfectly and holding exactly the reserve ratio they're supposed to, not a penny more, not a penny less.
And that leaves us with one final big question to think about. This clean model works great in theory, but what happens in the real world when banks get nervous and decide to hold extra reserves just in case? Or what happens when they get optimistic and try to lend out as much as possible? What happens when reality gets messy?